You're watching Greater Brockton. Mark Lindy, your host, and I promised you we would have Rob May, the city planner, back here in the studio to talk about a blueprint for Brockton and what that means and all the specifics. Rob, welcome
back.
Thank you. Good to see you. So, as a planner, mm-hmm. this is an easy one for you. What's a comprehensive plan? I think lay people out there that don't have a planning background, comprehensive means all-encompassing in a sense, but what are you trying to create?
Well, it is all-encompassing, but it is, as the name implies, it's a blueprint for Brockton. It's what we want to see, and we, I mean the community, the people, the business owners, the neighborhood associations, residents, faith-based groups, everybody. What do we see our community being in the next 30 years? And more importantly, how do we get to that position? So it will set out a series of goals and a series of recommendations that we'll be able to use to implement to be able to get to those locations. So we'll be looking at economic development, housing opportunities, job creation, transportation, open space and recreation, services and facilities for people in our community. And most importantly, the last chapter is really about the implementation.
So the goal of the whole overall project, what are the goal of goals?
The goal of goals is to provide we want to bring in as many people to get an idea. Our goal is to create a community that believes in itself, that values each other, and we are creating a community where we can use the assets that we have to leverage change, to build a community that is inclusive and supports development, both economic development, personal development for everybody in Brockton.
So, in other words, to borrow a phrase about it takes a village to raise a child, it takes a community to come up with a plan.
To build a city.
To build
yes.
a city.
Yes,
okay?
Very
and
much.
If you want to take the mayor's slogan, it takes a carpenter, you can throw that in as well. But you're not no. trying to dictate the plan. That's to me, that's what's refreshing, okay? I go back, I've lived here my whole life. My dad actually was on the planning board for 5 years. Okay?
Oh, really?
He was happy he was off because he opposed a hotel project and the then mayor didn't like it and he didn't get reappointed. So he said he had a vacation after that, but he felt that the residents' needs were more important. And when the mayor puts a planning board together or appoints boards and commissions, you have community activists, you got the knot in my backyard. So instead of forcing a plan down anybody's throats, you folks are trying to get people to come up with the plan and you're not... You have credentials, but everybody's opinion matters. It's what they want to see.
It does. For so long, Brockton has kind of wandered in the darkness. We hadn't had a plan that was reflective of what people wanted. It was a plan that had been created in 1996 by, you know, some technocrats, and it's a fairly good plan, but it didn't have a heart to it. It didn't have teeth to make it implementable. And a plan should be a living document that's supported by the people, and that the plan then supports the ordinances and policies and decision-making that goes on in the city as to where we spend our scarce resources. By bringing people into the planning process, I think we then deal with some of that, what we call NIMBYism, not in my backyard. If we all agree on what the future of our community is going to be, it's about what we want, not what we don't want. And so we're able to design other projects and more detailed plans in specific neighborhoods that address those concerns and try to eliminate some of those risk-averse knee-jerk reactions because you've been a part of the plan. You know what's going to be coming up in front of you.
Buy into the plan. So if you're helping yes. to create the plan, in all likelihood, you're not going to oppose it, okay? Did you do this in the past? Did you do this in the past in your previous jobs? I know you were in Somerville before.
Yes.
And you just look at Somerville, and Somerville's been transformed over the years.
Oh, it's amazing what's happened.
It's your leadership in the corner office, and it's the staff and the citizens that are there as well. But it's vibrant, and we can go into different parts of Brockton, and you can't use that word. Unfortunately, you can't use the word.
It's true.
There's enthusiasm, and I think you said something about self-image a few minutes ago. I think it's important. I've always been an internal and an external cheerleader. You can forget about the pom-poms, okay? I wouldn't look good with that. But
or the boots.
I hate when people beat up Brockton. It makes me crazy. If I'm someplace else and they're beating up Brockton, it's like, when I worked in Sharon, you live where? And I'm like, I'm proud. I live in Brockton. I graduated Brockton High.
Half the people who are beating up Brockton are from Brockton.
Mm-hmm.
And I admit, I've only been in the community 2 years. I've moved here from Somerville, originally from the Midwest. But even though I've just been here 2 years, it's my community. I'm part of this. I feel a great sense of community pride. We have a wonderful history. We're going to have a great future. We're dealing right now in the present to plan that future. And by getting people involved, I think they're going to become more mindful of the situations that are around them and feel more pride in their community. Because there's an old adage that people respect what you inspect. Mm-hmm. And I think by bringing people to the table and being part of this process, you get buy-in, and I think that that's what's going to build and continue to build the community pride.
What I've been amazed at is Brockton is very diverse, always has been, always will be. It doesn't matter what culture you're from. When Lithuanians were here before and Italians and you name it, they had pride in their neighborhoods, they cleaned up their houses. Okay, I'm going to tell you something. You see some very nice neighborhoods, Cape Verdeans,
yes.
Haitians. They're, you know, multi-generations living in a three-decker. You have three levels of family living in the same place. And
they were designed to
garden,
do that.
I mean, okay, there might be corn growing in the front yard, which is fine, okay? I don't know if that's a zoning issue or not.
No, not at
but
all.
But the colors are bright and vibrant, number one, okay? But everybody cares about the same things. They want a good job, a good education, good community, open space.
Yes.
Okay? I know the mayor stressed parks. He's worked very hard on different parks with the Parks and Rec Commission. I'm sure that's part of it. But why does the plan become so important? Is that a funding mechanism? Because grants, all you ever hear about is grants. I think the mayor put forward a grants coordinator within the city budget. So I know at the library, when we applied for a grant, unless we had a plan that we worked on ahead of time, we weren't going to get the grant. So does that have anything to do with it?
Some of it has to do with grant opportunities. There are projects that we would like to go forward on, and you need to be able to show how it fits into a comprehensive plan. And I think that that's very important coming from the state's perspective. A lot of the questions they ask us is, you know, does this, you know, Project X support the city's comprehensive plan? And we, you know, our plan was done in 1996. So maybe not. Things have changed. But it's also important because this is kind of a policy document that is going to drive programs in the city. It's going to drive the development of ordinances, and especially the zoning ordinance. And those are the tools that implement the plan. So by getting people involved in this plan, we're buying into our future.
I think we've answered this question, but I'm going to ask it in a different way. Everybody says there's apathy. Nobody cares. So sell it. Tell us why residents should care or be involved. Why should they get involved? Do they, you know, some of them might think, gee, they're going to come up with all the answers. Doesn't sound like that to me.
No, this is our city. We have to have a say in what we expect our city to be in the future. And by we, I mean every resident, every property owner, every business owner has got to have a voice in this process. We need to represent all the different groups in the city. It's really hard to reach out to everybody, and we're going to be trying our very best in getting the word out, and we hope that there's a lot of participation in this process. But if you don't become part of the solution, you're part of the problem. Mm-hmm. And not everybody can make these community meetings. So we understand that. We have a very active web page, which is www.ablueprintforbrockton.com, where you'll be able to participate online, sending questions and recommendations. We have a Twitter and a Facebook page. We are starting a campaign that we call hashtag, you know, it's a hashtag campaign.
Yeah.
So we're asking people to take pictures of places in Brockton that are the things that we like. And so we're using the hashtag Brockton's Best. We're also asking people, as they travel to other communities, if they see something that's really interesting that you think should be in Brockton, you should take a picture of it and hashtag it Brockton Needs. Mm-hmm. And so that's going to develop a series of photo montages that we're going to be able to use in a citywide survey, an image survey that is going to help us refine the plan. So people will be able to look online. There'll be a picture that you rate 1 to 10. Is this something that you like for our community? Is it something you don't like for our community? And so the nice thing about that is it overcomes a lot of cultural and language issues, because, you know, one is, you know, there'll be a smiley
picture's
face and a frown.
Picture's worth a thousand words, too.
Exactly. And it captures much more than just the building element. It's you know, do we want small businesses and family-owned entrepreneurs? Do we want tech jobs? Do we want single-family ranch housing, or do we want multifamily, you know, development downtown with first floor retail? How do we look at our parks? You know, are they passive recreation or are they open recreation? So there's a whole bunch of activities and questions that are out there, and this is the policy document that's going to guide us into the future.
So if I ask the question, how many people can be involved, the answer is almost
everybody.
Unlimited.
It's unlimited. Now, I know we're not going to get thousands of people at these community meetings. I wish we would. But there's dozens of ways of participating and in multiple languages. So if you have questions, we have people who will be able to translate that. You'll be able to send us a message at blueprintforbrockton.com or at gmail.com, on our Facebook page. If it's in a different language, we'll be able to translate that and get it back to people. So everybody has a chance to participate.
Now, I had you on before, but we'll just put it right sandwiched in the middle of this segment,
sure.
Too. You're doing the listening meetings. We talked about what they are, but when are they?
In June, towards the middle and end of June. So if I borrow my glasses again. Mm-hmm. Our first meeting is at North Middle School, and that's going to be on June 14th. Then at South Middle School will be Thursday, June 16th. Wednesday, June 22nd, we're going to be at East Middle School. And Thursday, June 23rd, we'll be at West Middle School. Now, these are, you know, designed to reach out to the residents. And hear what they've got to say. It's a series of mapping exercises, so you're not going to sit there and listen to me talk for 2 hours, thank God. But this is an opportunity for you to participate. There's going to be other opportunities after the summer. We'll be holding another series of meetings on the plan elements, so we'll be talking about economic development and transportation. We'll be talking about open space and community facilities. We'll be talking about housing and whatever the other element is.
So you answered my next question, which, will the listening meetings be the last chance for residents to participate? The answer is no.
It's open until it's done.
Because I remember hearing the council talk about, for years, different mayors, different councils, different personalities. We got to update our plan. I thought, actually, being a pretty good consumer of watching City Council, mm-hmm. and knowing what's going on in the community, that it was updated. But apparently I wasn't correct. So this is good. What's the timeline for this project? How long is this part going to go with the listening sessions and the subsequent meetings on the plan elements? Is it a year-long process? Is it a two-year process? Ballpark?
It should be a year to 18 months. Mm-hmm. There are elements that will take a little bit more detail. In addition to these community meetings, as we get closer to preparing a draft, those segments will be out for community comment before they're, you know, before it's finalized. Then there'll be a couple of public hearings, mm-hmm. Where people can offer testimony, which is a little bit more official, but is required by law. And you know, in the end, we'll take it to City Council, and that I hope will be in the fall of next year.
And you said that councils at large and councils are already involved.
Yes, they are.
They went out to reach out to the community and did a series of community meetings other than the council meeting. I know the four councils at large
are still
doing that right
now. Correct, the four out-larges are still doing them.
Okay, so that component's in there. You talked about the online engagement, that mm-hmm. people can engage online. But let's talk a little bit more. I think I got a 5-minute cue. The benefits of comprehensive planning. We talked about why it's important, but what are the benefits of doing it this way?
I think the benefits of doing it this way is by having a robust plan that everybody buys into. It easily can be done in a back room by a couple of staff members and the powers that be, but you don't get a plan that outlives the current administration or the current technocrats that are there. And without the community participation, community buy-in, there's no life to it. Mm-hmm. It ends up sitting on the shelf. The other benefits are we are actually creating this roadmap of where we want to go. And we're deciding, we the people are deciding how we want Brockton to look in the future. And as we go to apply for new grants, as we try to rebuild our roads, our schools, our playgrounds, our parks, these will all be identified in the plan, and it'll help us prioritize those issues. It'll help us direct what scarce resources that we have from our tax base, and will also help us to then attract potentially new businesses to the community, because we'll be able to show them this is what we're trying to do, these are the resources that we have, you know, to invest in this. We would like you to invest with us in this future Brockton.
It's probably not new in other places. It's new to here from my experience being here for a long time. We're not the only community working on a comprehensive plan, so I'm sure you go to all these different meetings and mm-hmm. conferences outside of the city, probably mostly within state, but we're by far not the only community working on this, right?
No, and if you've been watching the local news out of Boston, the city of Boston is working on its comprehensive plan right now. They hadn't done one in 30 years also. Mm. So we're in good company. But again, Cambridge is working on one. Somerville just finished one. I believe Easton is in the midst of one. Marlborough, has just finalized one. So it's becoming a very important tool. It's always been required by state law, but it's now becoming an important tool for implementing state grants and prioritizing the state resources that come to us.
And I know the state people have been coming down to Brockton.
Quite a bit.
Saying you asked, now we'll help you.
Yes.
Okay. Well, thank you. We're going to
keep
updated, and we'll bring you back on TV, and we'll focus on this. This is an important issue for the
looking
community.
Looking forward to it.
Thanks. You're watching Greater Brockton. Mark Lindy, your host. Stay tuned for more events, places, people, and faces right here in the City of Champions.